take a look at the animation on the screen. In this animation, you will find that a boy is holding up a spoon in front of him. Now, when he's holding the spoon close to him, he can see his image on the spoon. Now, when he is moving the spoon away from him, you will notice that the size and shape of the image is changing. Now, why do you think this is happening? Can we find out diagrammatically how this change of size of the image is taking place? Let us find out. Before we talk about how we can obtain it diagrammatically, let us define what a ray diagram is. A ray diagram is a diagram through which we can find the location, type, and size of the image. So let us say that we have an object and a spherical mirror provided, and we have to find out through a ray diagram the location, type, and size of the image. How can we do so? Let us say we have to find the image of a particular point on the object. So from one particular point, we consider rays, incident rays, traveling in the outward direction. These are incident on the surface of the mirror, and after reflection, they will travel in the opposite direction. So by tracing out the incident rays and after hitting the mirror, the reflected rays, we can find out the location, type, and size of the image. Because we know, in case of a concave mirror, the reflected rays will converge at a point in space, and in case of a convex mirror, the reflected rays will seem to be diverging from a point behind the mirror. Now you must be wondering that there are many rays of light which are leaving an object. So do we need to consider all these rays incident on a mirror? You will be interested to know that we do not need to consider all these rays. Because as you can obviously see, if we have to consider all these rays that have been shown, the task of drawing a ray diagram would become very tedious. So what rays do we consider? We consider only two rays. The first ray we consider is a ray passing through the center of curvature of the mirror. And the second ray we consider is a ray parallel to the principal axis. Why do we consider these two rays? We shall soon find out. Now consider the first instance. We have considered a ray that is passing through the center of curvature of the concave mirror. Here you will find that when the ray of light is incident on the concave mirror through the center of curvature, it is hitting the mirror at a particular point. Now, when this ray of light is passing through the center of curvature, irrespective of the point that it is hitting on the mirror, this ray will always be perpendicular to the mirror. In other words, this ray is normal to the tangent drawn at that point on the mirror. Even if we draw a ray that is hitting at this point and passing through the center of curvature, this ray will be normal to the tangent drawn at this point. So since it is coinciding with the normal, what can we say? The angle of incidence is zero. And as we know, the angle of incidence is equal to the angle of reflection. So the angle of reflection is also zero. As a result, a ray that passes through the center of curvature and hits the mirror is reflected back along its own path. That is, along the same direction it had traveled. Now in case of a convex mirror, if we have a ray of light that is appearing to pass through the center of curvature of the mirror, it will be reflected along its own path. Because even in the case of a convex mirror, the ray of light that is appearing to pass through the center of curvature is normal to the tangent at that point. And it holds true for any point. So after reflection, since the angle of incidence is zero, the angle of reflection will also be zero, and the ray will be reflected along its own path. Now, consider the second ray. We had considered that the second ray to be parallel to the principal axis. This is the principal axis. Now, in case of a concave mirror, when a ray parallel to the principal axis falls on the concave mirror, after reflection, passes through a point that is the focus. Now, always remember that this is true for all rays that are parallel to the principal axis. So, what can we conclude? That in case of a concave mirror, whenever we have a ray parallel to the principal axis incident on the mirror, it will always pass through the focus after reflection. In the case of a convex mirror, what happens? A ray parallel to the principal axis is reflected in such a way that it appears to be coming from, or it appears to be diverging from, the focus that lies behind the mirror. So a ray parallel to the principal axis either passes or appears to pass through the focus after reflection. Now consider these two images that have been shown. Here, in case of a convex mirror, a ray diagram has been drawn with the help of the two rays that we discussed. One ray is parallel to the principal axis, and the other ray is appearing to pass through the center of curvature. The ray parallel to the principal axis after reflection appears to be coming from a point behind the mirror, that is the focus, and the ray that appeared to be crossing the center of curvature is reflected back along its own path. So if we extrapolate these two rays, that is, produce them backwards, we find that we are obtaining an image on the other side of the mirror. This image is virtual, as we cannot obtain it on a screen. Similarly, in case of a concave mirror, two rays have been considered. The first ray is parallel to the principal axis, and after reflection, it passes through the focus. The second ray considered is passing through the center of curvature, and after reflection, it is passing back along its own path. So the point where these two rays meet is the point where the image is being formed. This image is a real image, as it is obtained in the real world and can be obtained on a screen. Now you must be wondering how two rays are sufficient to obtain the image of the object. Now let us consider a situation where we have more than two rays. Let us say we consider this ray that is parallel to the principal axis. After reflection, it passes through the focus. And we consider this ray that passes through the focus. After reflection, it becomes parallel to the principal axis. Now, no matter which two rays coming from the object we consider, we will find that they always meet at the image. So what can we say? We can say that no matter what two rays we take, they will always lie in this region, that is, within the image, and two rays are thus sufficient to obtain the location, size, and type of the image. So what did we learn? We learned that a ray diagram can be used to obtain the image of an object. What is a ray diagram? A ray diagram is a diagram which is used to obtain the location, type, and size of the object. For drawing a ray diagram, we are considering two rays. One ray that is parallel to the principal axis, it passes through the focus or appears to diverge from the focus after reflection. And the other ray passes through the center of curvature or appears to pass through the center of curvature and after reflection retraces its own original path.